This ancient, ugly text file is like the Rosetta Stone of the internet's voice. It looks like junk, but without it, your video calls simply would not exist. It looks like something from the 90s, because it is. It's called the Session Description Protocol, and despite being older than some of you watching this video, it silently enables virtually every video call platform, Zoom, Google Meet, Discord, FaceTime, even Stream. This isn't some legacy system we're stuck with. This is actively how our cutting-edge communication works today. Let's say you and I decide to have a video call. We're probably in different places, on different networks, with different devices, maybe behind firewalls. Before we can even start sending video, our devices need to agree on dozens of technical details. What video codecs can we support? What's your IP address? Do you prefer UDP or TCP? What ports are open? Can you receive audio? What about screen sharing? This is where SDP comes in. It's essentially a language for describing media sessions. Think of it as a complete technical blueprint that one device sends to another, saying, here's everything about me and what I can do. Before we dive into why it looks so strange, we need to go back to where it all began. The mid-1990s, the internet was exploding. Websites were ugly, connections were slow, and a revolutionary idea was emerging. What if we could make phone calls over the internet? Voice over IP, or VoIP, was going to disrupt the traditional phone companies, but engineers needed standardized ways for these systems to communicate. So in 1998, the Internet Engineering Task Force published RFC 2327, defining the Session Description Protocol. It wasn't designed for video calls as we know them today. It was made for a companion protocol called SIP, the Session Initiation Protocol, which basically was a way to set up, modify, and tear down multimedia sessions like phone calls over the internet. Fast forward to 2011. Google acquires a company called Global IP Solutions and open sources their video conferencing technology, known as WebRTC, Web Real-Time Communication. The goal was ambitious, to enable real-time audio, video, and data transfers without any plugins involved. They could have created something entirely new, but instead, they chose to adopt this existing protocol, SDP, which was already more than a decade old at this point. Why? The same reason engineers make a lot of decisions. They did not want to reinvent the wheel. It wasn't adopted because it was beautiful. It was adopted because it was there. It was duct tape, battle tested, and just good enough. That's how a text format from the dial-up era ended up powering our modern video calls. Okay, let's crack this thing open. What is all this gibberish actually saying? I'm gonna open up the Chrome DevTools during a WebRTC connection. Here it is. Each line starts with a single letter followed by an equal sign. These are the types of the information being shared. Let's break down the key parts. V equals 0, that's the version. It's always 0. Always. For the last 25 years, there is no version 1. O is the origin line. It contains the session ID, a version number for this specific negotiation, and network information. Think of it as the unique identifier for this particular conversation. S and T are mostly legacy fields from the 90s. Session name and timing. In WebRTC, they're almost always just placeholders, nothing more. Like vestigial logins, in a sense. Now we get to the meat of it, the media sections. M equals audio and M equals video define the media types being offered. Each is followed by a preferred port number, the transport protocol, and a list of supported codecs represented by numbers. Those numbers, they just shorthand for actual codec names, which get defined later. Lines starting with A equals RTB map, map those numbers to actual codec names and parameters. So codec 111 might be defined as Opus Audio at 48,000 Hz. A equals FMTP provides the format parameters for those codecs. Think of it as the fine-tuning. I want H.264 video, but specifically with those settings. Then we get into connectivity. A equals ICE UFRAG and A equals ICE password provide credentials for something called ICE, Interactive Connectivity Establishment, which helps pierce through firewalls and NATs. This is where SDP and ICE intersect. SDP describes the call, and ICE makes it happen. The A equals candidate lines list potential network paths your data could take. Your local IP, your public IP, relay servers. We'll dig deeper into ICE in our next video. A equals fingerprint and A equals setup handle the encryption setup. They ensure your call is secure and cannot be intercepted. Finally, lines like A equals mid, A equals send receive, and A equals group bundle control how the session works, which tracks are grouped together, who can send or receive what, and so on. So that's SDP. It's verbose, it's detailed, and it kind of has to be, because video calling is really incredibly complex. We build video calling here at Stream, and we know it is. In WebRTC, SDP is something called an offer-answer model. One device creates an offer, essentially saying, here's what I can do. The other device examines it and creates an answer SDP, saying, here's what I can do from your list. Here's where it gets messy. The WebRTC specification doesn't necessarily state how browsers should generate or interpret SDP. So Chrome might create an SDP different from Safari, different from Firefox, and so on. This has caused countless headaches for developers trying to build cross-browser video calling application. Around 2013, a controversy erupted in the WebRTC community. Google, Microsoft, and others proposed an alternative called ORTC, Object Real-Time Communications. Instead of this weird text format in SDP, ORTC would use JavaScript objects to achieve the same thing. It was cleaner, more logical, easier to work with. It separated different concerns properly, it was more intuitive, but it did not matter. SDP was too big to fail at that point. Eventually, some ORTC concepts were incorporated back into the WebRTC standard, but SDP remained the foundation. And that's the beauty of technology standards. They can outlive their original context and become the foundation for things their creators never ever imagined. By the way, if you're interested, we also created a course called WebRTC for the Brave, which explores several aspects of WebRTC as well as actually implementing it in a real-world project. So if you want to, go check it out, links in the description. Now that we understand the handshake between these two devices, the next question is, how do these devices connect across networks and firewalls halfway around the world? In our next episode, we dive into this concept, which is ICE, TUN, and TURN servers, the hidden infrastructure of how devices find each other over the internet. And that's it. Thanks for watching, thanks for bearing with me, and we'll see you next time.